I'm thrilled to be joined by Obi Felten, who is the head of Getting Moonshots Ready for Contact with the Real World at X, Alphabet's Moonshot Factory. I followed her work for a while, and Obi, I think you have one of the most interesting job titles I have ever discovered. Really excited to have you talk with us about your work at X and its relevance to the work that our community at Devex is doing around the world. So just to get started, can you tell us, what does it mean to get these moonshot innovations you're working on at X ready for contact with the real world, for those who are less familiar?
Great. Thank you so much, Catherine. It's really wonderful to be with you here. So my job at X is to take new technologies out of the lab and into the real world. And I've been here for 8 years, and we just celebrated our 10th anniversary. So it feels like a long time. And in that time, I've worked on projects like self-driving cars, internet from balloons, delivery drones, smart contact lenses for diabetics, energy storage using molten salt, agricultural robots, and carbon neutral fuel from seawater. So a real range of very different tech projects. And what they all have in common is that many of them sound like science fiction when we first start. Not all of them succeed, which is to be expected. So our mission is what really brings these projects together, and that is to invent and launch moonshot technologies that make the world a radically better place. And we say that with all like full sincerity in Silicon Valley. When I go to Europe, people sometimes sort of smile at that. But we really believe that we can combine purpose and profit. And our world really, our projects really sit at the intersection of that. So our goal commercially is to create new companies for Alphabet that can scale and have impact at scale. But we always want to make sure that we're solving a really big, challenging problem in the world, and that our world, our work ultimately makes the world a better place.
So as you pursue that mission, and of all the many problems that could benefit from that kind of approach, how do you prioritize which problems you want to take on?
Right, that's a great question. So many of our projects were inspired by the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So you can see themes like climate change and ocean health as one of our projects, infrastructure such as transportation, mobility, and internet access, and also a healthcare, which we spun out as a separate company called Verily. So we pick projects where technology can make a meaningful contribution to tackling these huge challenges in the world. But we also acknowledge that technology is never the full solution. So none of these problems will be solved by technology alone. So climate change, I think, is a really good example of that, where yes, technology can contribute things, for instance, like pulling carbon out of the air, which is something we're going to have to do in order to reach our climate goals. But in order to do that, technology companies such as ours have to work with regulators, they have to work with governments, they have to work with other partners in the industries that we're bringing the technology to bear. So our technology is always molded and shaped by all of these different forces. It's not just sort of physics and engineering. It's also actually very human forces when the projects make contact with the real world. And I want to give you a couple of examples that are sort of very fresh. So one example is, I've talked in the past a lot about Project Loon, which is our Internet from Balloons project. But we actually have another project in that space of internet access, which is called Tara. And they are using optical beams so to connect two stations. So it's ground-based, but it's very flexible. So you could put like one of the stations on top of a building in a part of a city and another station somewhere else. You could put one on top of a hill to connect a remote village. And they're actually piloting right now in sub-Saharan Africa. So they're testing in Kenya right now, and they're learning from like this very real world deployment, you know, where they're working with real people who are getting their internet through this new method. And their partner is Econet, which is a large telco in sub-Saharan Africa. Mm-hmm. So while that's a baby pilot at the moment, that's enabling us to sort of refine the technology, we then are also always thinking about like, how can we find partners that will help us scale the technology when it becomes more mature?
Great. Now, another question I have for you is, I'm just putting myself in the shoes of some people who might be watching and, you know, wondering, maybe having some skepticism, like, what can X in Silicon Valley teach me in the context where I work, you know? And yet I've really enjoyed hearing from you and some of your colleagues over the years about some of your learnings And I do think there's real relevance what you're learning at X, between what you're learning at X and what, you know, global development professionals are working in and day out. So my question for you is, what can the global development community learn from X's approach to innovation and learnings around bringing innovation to scale over the years?
Mm-hmm. So first of all, I want to say, I think it's always a two-way learning process, right? So we have learned an enormous amount from our partners, but we've also found that some of the things that we have learned at X over the last 10 years are applicable outside our context. And so I would say there's no formula for innovation, but the lessons we've learned, you can think of them more like ingredients that you can use in your own recipe and in your own context. So there's no sort of like, if someone tells you like, here's the Bible of like how to do a tech innovation, like don't believe them, right? But one universal theme is that the real secret to innovation really comes down to people and culture. We have to overcome very powerful forces that cause people to retreat to the comfortable and the conventional. And part of that is actually the fear of failure, which I think is a bigger mm-hmm. impediment to innovation than either, you know, funding or kind of inherent structures. And that's because these fears of failure run very deep and they're very real, right? So we might be worried about losing face in front of our colleagues if the thing we work on failed, or our promotion, or a startup, if we're running a startup, or our funding, you know, if we have to go back to our funder and say, actually, this thing that we did didn't really work. So we have various tricks at X of how we can sort of counterbalance that. The first is accepting that some of the things we do are going to fail and reframing it in terms of like failing fast, which is a sort of Silicon Valley cliche that anyone outside Silicon Valley thinks like, really, are people really talking about that? I personally don't think it's helpful. I think it's much more helpful to reframe it as learning fast, because you do want to find out as quickly as possible if a program you're running or a technology you're piloting is not going to work, right? So if you think of it in those terms of like, how can you learn as quickly as possible what works and doesn't work? And that means at X, that means working on the hardest thing first. We have this image of a monkey on a pedestal. What if you try and teach them how to recite Shakespeare? Do you build the pedestal or do you teach the monkey first? It turns out teaching the monkey is the hard bit that you should be focusing on. Otherwise you're left with this beautiful but useless pedestal. So that's very counterintuitive. So, you know, really making a list of the risks and then tackling the hardest risk first. The second thing we found helpful is when we start a project, we set success criteria. So we imagine what the world will look like when we succeed. And that's of course what we're hoping will happen, but we also set kill criteria up front so that we know when to wind down an effort. And that could just be like a new prototype we're working on for a project, or it could be an entire project. And so I think that is, some of those things are very, you know, universally applicable. You could do that in any organization, whether it's large or small, whether they're working in technology or not.
Absolutely. And I do think there are so many of those lessons that, you know, people watching right now can apply today. But some of those lessons, there are real challenges in applying them because, for example, funders might not allow you to fail. And that might be why you're afraid to fail. And that's something that X might have more flexibility than a lot of NGOs in this space, but I still think something to strive for.
Yeah, very true, very true. So I'm on the board of a number of nonprofits, including a UK nonprofit called Shift, who have done actually some research and some white papers in the space of that there's often like a valley of death of technology innovation, because funders in the social venture space look at it as too similar to like programs. So in the traditional kind of funding world, you'd run a pilot program. When that program works, you then roll out and you can scale. But tech doesn't really work that way. Like you build a technology product as a pilot, and then you constantly have to iterate over and over and over again. And that middle part is what funders are often unwilling to fund, for instance. Like, so how do you make it good enough so that it can eventually scale and then continue to evolve it, right? Like you don't build a finished product and then you just scale it. So kind of exactly. Funders that are willing to bridge that valley of death, which we see in the commercial world too. So mm-hmm. for instance, we often take projects out of academia that sound completely impossible, like science fiction, like self-driving cars. You know, that was decades of academic research that flowed into them. And then it was only when we built a car that was actually fully autonomous that people in venture capital said, oh, actually this is doable. And now there's a flurry of startups in that space. So I think you can do a lot to like educate your funders. Yeah. I mean, I stood up at a sort of non-profit funder conference once and said, like, you know, you need to ask them to tell you about your failures, not just the successes when they come to re-pitch you. And they all looked at me like I was talking another language. But I think the best funders will do that. And so going after people who are with you on that journey is what I would definitely advise.
Well, great point to end on. I wish we could keep the conversation going, but I know we have to keep it short, shorter than I'd like. But thank you so much, Obi, for joining us and sharing some of your insights.
You're welcome. And thank you for having me.